Welcome to the week 4 lecture for Composing with Sound, entitled, What is Composing? These are some of the things we're going to do during this lecture. The early feedback survey is now open and I'd like you to do that this week, so I'll give you some time to do that during the lecture. I'm going to introduce concepts of sound organisation. I'm going to talk about organising sound in time. I'm going to play some examples, and I'm going to introduce a loose performance score of some semi-improvised music that we'll be working on in week 5. So here's the link to the early feedback survey. I'd love to hear your thoughts on the subject so far. www.sfs.uts.edu.au. I think there's only 4 or 5 questions. It shouldn't take much more than 10 minutes. I'll let you jump online and do that now. Okay, so to recap on what we've done so far, we have differentiated sounds as discrete aspects of auditory perception from the idea of sound as a general concept. And we talked about auditory grouping and streaming as ways in which sounds come to cohere and become discrete. We've described sound shapes in terms of spectromorphology, that is, the form or shape of the spectrum as it evolves over time. And we've discussed envelopes and classes of sound shape. We've introduced the idea of gesture and source bonding as aspects of the listening imagination. And these concepts, source bonding, the listening imagination, and spectrum morphology, come from the composer Dennis Smalley. We've considered complex morphologies, that is, sound shapes that evolve over time, or extended sound shapes or textures. And now I want to explore the idea of musical form. So here's a quote from the Oxford Companion to Music. Form can be said to be the way in which the various elements in a piece of music, its pitches, rhythms, dynamics, timbres, are organized in order to make it coherent to a listener. Unlike painting, sculpture, or architecture, musical form can't be apprehended all at once or examined for an extended period of time. Music is a temporal art form, and in performance we can't rehear a detail or a part of a work. Therefore, music has commonly used some form of repetition to produce the impression of organized coherence. When we think of musical form, we often think of a limited set of patterns of construction that a musical work must conform to. There are typically sets of sectional forms that you might learn about in high school music, for example. Binary form, two contrasting sections. Ternary form, where the first section repeats, sometimes in identical form or sometimes slightly transformed. Compound binary form, so this is where the two halves of the piece can each be subdivided, and the classical sonata form is an example of that. Rondo form has a repeated section that comes back again and again. Now, this is usually instrumental music, so we wouldn't necessarily call it a refrain. There's a form called theme and variations, where we get an initial idea and it's varied each time it's repeated. Typical song forms, we might have verse, 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 or verse, chorus, verse, chorus, or verse, chorus, verse, chorus, chorus, chorus type song structures that you're all very familiar with from popular music. And then there is the idea of a form that isn't organized around repetition, sometimes called through-composed or single-section form, where there's no large repeating elements in the structure. So Arnold Schoenberg is an important composer from the 20th century, and he wrote quite a few books on books of instruction on composition. And here's a quote from Arnold Schoenberg. He said that form means that a piece is organized. That is, it consists of elements functioning like those of a living organism. The chief requirements for the creation of a comprehensible form are logic and coherence. The presentation, development, and interconnection of ideas must be based on relationship. So there's some rather abstract ideas here. Logic and coherence, what might that mean in terms of musical composition? And how might we think about a relationship between elements within larger scale forms? Okay, I've got another important 20th century composer, Edgar Varèse. You might not have heard of him, but he took a slightly different direction in the concept of form. In particular, he was not interested in music that was based on repetition. The traditional world of notes, instrumental music as we know it, provides only a limited subset of all the sonic material that a composer might choose to work with. Now, Varèse was working before tape recorders, before sound recording became a common element within musical composition. And he came up with the idea of organized sound. So this in some ways reflects the ideas of Schoenberg, but I think he had some rather different concepts. He said that composition is the growth and interaction of sound masses in space through a continual process of expansion, projection, interaction, penetration, and transmutation. So once again, some rather abstract ideas. And to try and make this a little bit more concrete, I'm going to play you a piece from an orchestral work that he composed in 1918. So this is after the First World War. The piece is called Amerix. So he's imagining the modern New World, as it was called, the world of America, big cities built around industrial development, the motor car, industrialization, and mass urbanization. And he tried to capture these sound masses interpenetrating and transmutating in this orchestral work about modernity. So I think this little excerpt gives you a real sense of the kind of visceral nature of these sound masses. And he introduced a whole range of new sounds into the orchestra, things like sirens and whistles and various other kinds of noise-making devices. He had quite a bit to say on musical form. He said, it's a misunderstanding to think of form as a point of departure, a pattern to be followed, a mould to be filled. Form is a result. It's the result of a process. Each of my works, he said, discovers its own form. So when he was thinking of a mould or a pattern, a mould to be filled, he was thinking of these forms that come from the classical period, binary, ternary, and so forth. He quoted a professor of mineralogy comparing the production of music to crystals. The crystal is characterized by both a definite external form and a definite internal structure. It is the internal structural unit of the crystal, which is the smallest grouping of the atoms, that has the order and composition of the substance. The extension space forms the whole crystal. In spite of the variety of internal structures, the external forms are limitless. So you might think of ice crystals, salt crystals, quartz crystals. They have a sense of order to them, but they grow slowly from the smallest elements, and the larger scale structure is determined by these small elements. He says, crystal form is itself a resultant rather than a primary attribute. Crystal form is a consequence of the interaction of attractive and repulsive forces, the ordered packing of the atom. So the primary attribute is the atomic structure, and as the crystal grows, we get a resultant form that's dependent on circumstances. This idea of attractive and repulsive forces really brings to my mind some of the sounds like we heard in that little excerpt. So the concept of organized sound, which is really an idea that Varese introduced, has been taken up by a lot of contemporary composers, particularly in the field of electronic music. And the American composer Curtis Rhodes is one of those. He says, the philosophy of organized sound places great emphasis on the initial stage of composition, the construction and selection of the sound materials. Just as the molecular properties of mud, thatch, wood, stone, steel, glass, and concrete determine the architectural structures that one can construct with them, sonic morphology inevitably shapes the higher layers of musical structure. So this harks back to the idea of the quartz structure, but interestingly, for Curtis Rhodes, he was one of the pioneers of some interesting synthesis techniques. In particular, he was interested in granular synthesis, where small grains of sound, maybe 30 or 40 milliseconds in length, are aggregated together to make large sound masses. Now, this piece that I'm going to play, N-Score, is not an example of granular synthesis. This is more an example of direct synthesis through different types of distortion. But I'll let you have a listen to this. So we could describe that structure of that little excerpt as a series of sort of growth processes, and each one of those digital sound processes produced a unique kind of medium scale structure. So this idea of structure at different scales is an important idea that Curtis Rhodes explores. He calls it multi-scale organization. So for the electronic or computer musician, we are composing the sounds themselves and then using those sounds to build larger scale musical structures. Rhodes suggests that composition embodies an ancient dualism between formalism and intuition. that is between forms that are part of a tradition and the imaginative intuition that creates new and radical departures from tradition. By multi-scale organisation, I mean an approach to composition that takes into account the perceptual and physical reality of multiple interacting timescales, each of which can be composed. So this is the thing that's new in electronic music. So previously, the sound of the violin was pre-composed. It was part of the tradition. But with a computer, we can create our own sounds at any scale of organisation. So this is a diagram from his book on electronic music composition. And we have classes of time scale, which he calls supra, macro, meso, and micro. So we can think of time in terms of periods. So the largest period would be the physical age of the universe. So thinking on a very, very large scale. Then at a human scale, we can think of years, months, days, hours, minutes. And, you know, composers such as the American composer Lamont Young have tried to make compositions that go for a period of years. John Cage also thought in terms of compositions that would span that amount of time. But at the level of the note, we're really talking about sounds that last from 50 to 100, maybe 200, 300 milliseconds. Rhodes uses the term sound object to refer to that period. Once we get below a duration of about 50 milliseconds, we start to hear a click. We heard that with our exploration of envelopes. And we get down to the zone of frequencies, pitch perceptions, audible frequencies. There we go. The middle C, which has a frequency of 261 hertz, has a period of about 3.8 milliseconds. And anything below that is ultrasonic. And we can see here the sampling rate of digital audio, 44,100 samples per second. And then we get down to something that's infinitesimally small in terms of the duration of time. And I guess the sort of threshold point is the inverse of infinity. You know, what is zero time? And there's this notion of the now. So these sorts of timescales, we get around half a second, we get echo effects, or at these less than a minute, we get repetition, for example, the repetition of a verse. We get doubling, flanging, and phasing effects down at these smaller frequency periods. And then when we're talking about the delays in terms of period of sound, this is where we get filtering effects. So thinking in terms of the passage of time or our awareness of the passage of time, you know, you probably got a good memory of a year or a couple of years. Interestingly, he's put the frequency there of a year. There's a concept in perceptual psychology that the present is made up of a period of time that remains in our perception of around 600 milliseconds. Periods of around 20 milliseconds give us what's called the precedence effect, the difference in time of arrival between the two ears. We're sensitive to that in the order of about 1 millisecond. Delays less than 1 millisecond produce rather strange, harsh, metallic sounds. Then thinking of timescales in terms of perception and action, so this is where an instrumentalist's performance comes in. You know, we can think about action over the scale of a human lifetime. Usual composition is anywhere, you know, typical pop song is 3 minutes long. Classical composition, a movement might be 15 or 20 minutes long. We can play tremolo or vibrato sounds or sing them at a rate of about 8 hertz. And once we get down to somewhere around the 10 millisecond mark, we're talking about the threshold of pitch perception. So this diagram gives us a sense of the different scales that we can organize sound over, right from the kind of digital audio workstation filtering and effects processing up to the level of a repeated chorus and ultimately to the length of a composition, 3 or 5 minutes. So this idea of using human perception as a way of understanding the structure of compositions was explored by the English-Norwegian composer Natasha Barrett. And she explored the idea of a listening process. So talking about a composition that perhaps lasts for 13 minutes, there is a process that's bound by that time scope. But when we're listening, we're drawing in from a much larger time scale to do with our memory. And in particular, in this piece, Little Animals, that we'll hear an excerpt from, she was interested in memories from her childhood, and she was hoping to link those into the listener's memory or imagination. And so this little diagram here positions the music at the center of, you know, a set of concepts. There is real space, imagined space, which is what this Little Animals piece is about. Our imagination as a listener, what we bring to the listening experience, and the real world inspiration that for her as the composer informed this music. I'll just play a little excerpt of this alongside a graphic score that was created for analysis by the composer herself. So this piece, very much informed by the concepts of gesture and texture that we heard from Dennis Smalley. In fact, Natasha Barrett studied composition under Dennis Smalley. So I want to introduce some other approaches to structuring sound on larger scales. So here we're talking about semi-improvised music or semi-structured music. And a classic example of this is Terry Riley's piece In C from 1968. So it can be performed on any instrument, and the score is made up of 53 melodic patterns, and the ensemble sequences through them And the idea is that you start on pattern number one and you keep playing it until you hear other people have moved on to pattern number two. And then you move on and you keep playing that until you hear somebody has moved on to pattern number three and so forth. And so the transitions from each pattern are sort of blurred and unpredictable. So it does have a clear structure, but the unfolding of the structure is going to be different each time based on the different instruments that are used to realize it and the rate at which the ensemble moves through it. Let's hear a little piece of this. This is from a recording from the Bang on a Can All Stars. So I have developed a very simple little score, semi-structured score, for us to create a performance with our the instruments that we're currently working on. The performance goes only for a minute. It has three contrasting sections. The first section is, well, let's just have a look at this graphic representation. So the idea here is that the vertical axis is meant to be pitch, from low pitch to high pitch, and the horizontal is time in seconds. So, and the idea of the first section is that we get short staccato pitched sounds of any pitch. So it's the pitch that you choose to play is up to you, and you can play just one pitch or you can jump around in pitch, and the pitches. We don't know what sort of pitches we're going to get. Then there's a transition to section two in which everybody settles down on either an A or an E. So centered on A3 at 440 or E4 at 660 or any other A or E in any octave, produce a continuous sound with constant variation in either loudness or timbre or pitch but the pitch variation should be limited to plus or minus one semitone. So that's this kind of fluctuating shape. The fluctuation can occur in any of those elements depending on how you design your patch. And so that A and E lasts for, so it's a sort of open fifth sound, lasts for another 20 seconds. And then we get to the final section in which we get short staccato sounds of any pitch. But rather than the pitch remaining constant, or rather than the sound remaining constant, they can be little inflected short notes that vary in pitch. So they could be a little swooping sound, a very short swooping sound, or a sound that changes in timbre or loudness. And we get a cloud of randomized pitches with little variations in each. So this is a kind of repetition of this idea, but with some kind of development. So very, very simple. Your instrument that you're developing needs to be able to produce both short and long sustained sounds. And it also is required to be able to produce variation in two dimensions. And those two dimensions could be loudness or timbre or pitch. And you will have seen some examples with the subtractive synthesis patch or the noise subtraction subtractive patch. And any of those are possibilities for you to develop. You might use an envelope generator. You might come up with some other approaches to creating sound for this piece. That's what we're working towards. There are some references for the material that I've referred to in the lecture, and that completes the lecture. Please bring any questions that you have into the tutorial or ask them immediately at the end of the lecture. I look forward to seeing you in the tutorial.